Oh, gosh. What an introduction. Thank you very much. In fact, I should say, Jane, they say in broadcasting circles that you get to address an MRS audience twice in your broadcasting career, once on the way up and once on the way down. And it's good to be back for my second go because I did your awards ceremony. And I can't remember, actually, whether I told the story of the awards ceremony or not, but I'm going to tell anyway because it's absolutely illustrative, it seems to me, of what we're going to be discussing now. And it's very short, and it's about the moment that Barack Obama was elected in 2008, and I was the US correspondent at the BBC, and you surveyed the papers the morning after, all those incredibly dull US papers, they're very pedantic, the headlines read, Barack Obama elected President of the United States, 44th President, etc., etc., etc. One paper, I thought, captured the real essence of the moment, and that paper was The Onion, the satirical newspaper, and The Onion's headline was, Black Man Given Nation's Worst Job. And there is a kind of sense where, you know, everyone here is up for the challenge, the multiple challenges that Jane has outlined some of, and you're going to be discussing later in the day. But at the same time, I think it's fair to say there is a realization, whether it's the shock of the new or not, we can discuss, but there is a shock going on at the moment, and it's to do with information, and it's to do with the way people deal with their lives, both accessing information, it seems to me, but also, really crucially, what they then do with it, how they feel about each other, which is fascinating to someone who's in the news. There's a very wounding story John Major tells about sound bites, about when he went to Russia, and I suppose it was the early 1990s, he goes to see Boris Yeltsin, and they have a kind of walk through the Kremlin at the beginning of their talks, and the Major says he thinks he ought to make conversation with Yeltsin, so he turns to Yeltsin and he says, Boris, in a word, what is the state of your country? To which Yeltsin replies, in a word, good. And Major thinks, oh my God, because this is the early 90s, there are people starving in the streets in Russia. The answer is a lie. It's patently not true. And all his civil servants are already wondering if he's up to the job and thinking he's an idiot. He's been fobbed off with his answer. So Major says he's wondering what to do. And he, just as they get to the meeting room, he turns back to Yeltsin and he says, Boris, what is the what's the longer version of that? To which Yeltsin replies, not good. Which seems to me to tell a deep and wounding truth about not just the disutility, if that's a word, of sound bites, but also the kind of obfuscatory nature sometimes of what we assume information is and what individual people assume information is. The information, of course, on which they base their views on everything, views which you then get from them and potentially use. Views which may well be based, as you well know, on all sorts of misunderstandings about the world. Possibly more misunderstandings now than in days gone by. So I want to sort of throw it open now. We'll have a discussion up at the top, and then we've got microphones, and we want to include as many people as possible, and we've got a reasonable amount of time to do it. And I just wanted to start with where public trust is, really, with the idea of people of authority losing its position, we're all quite used to, and it's been around for a bit, but just kind of this sense of whether it's possible now for people genuinely to trust, and in what sense they trust institutions, brands, and on what they base their trust. Now, I'm not going to do sort of great long introductions of people here, and I think you're going to be able to see who they are up at the top. Yeah, there we go. So, and you'll know several of them. But if I start on my far right, as it were, not necessarily politically, though possibly with Patrick Barwise, and then sitting next to him, Camilla Harrison, then Lorraine Heggessey here, John Kearon here, and Matthew Taylor on my far left, which probably is about right. Seating-wise, Patrick Barwise, kick us off with this business of public trust. Where are we? Where are the public?
Well, obviously, there is much less trust in authority figures and a lot of institutions than in the past, but that's not true universally, and there are a lot of brands that are very highly trusted. There is only one way to build trust, and that is, you know, in marriage and in business and in politics, and that's to keep your promises. And so the the highly trusted institutions in general are the ones that have been seen to keep their promises. A lot of retailers are very highly trusted. Okay. So the John Lewis Partnership, and Waitrose, people like that. And the reason they're highly trusted is because consumers trust their own experience. They trust their own experience, and they trust the experience of people they know very, very well, close friends, family, and so on. They also trust academics, I'm happy to say, and they trust doctors, and so on. So it's not the case that no one is trusted as much as they used to be, but it is the case that all marketers, if you like, they'd like some more trust, but not every company has faced up to the reality of that, which is you have to have a very, very clear and relevant promise to the customer, and obviously customer insight is crucial for deciding what's relevant, and then you just have to work very, very hard to make sure that it's delivered again and again.
And if you cock it up and explain yourself, I mean, are there opportunities now, and I'm thinking of social media, I'm thinking of the whole business of the kind of interactivity that used to exist but does now potentially and really, are there opportunities to redeem yourself that didn't exist before?
Well, there are opportunities both ways because, the market will come and bite you on the backside very, very quickly because of social media. Having said which, 90% of conversations about brands are offline, mostly face-to-face, and of the other 10%, maybe 2 or 3% are through the well-known online social media, and the rest are through, text messages and so on. So I think that one of the besetting sins of marketing... is neophilia. The latest thing gets overhyped. And then, when the bubble bursts, usually something is left. And the biggest bubble in the last 20 years has been the internet. But when the internet bubble burst in spring 2000, we still had the internet and it changed an awful lot of things. Mm. But it didn't change everything the way we were told. So, yes, there are these new ways of doing things. And that means that... if something bad happens and it goes viral, then the message goes around the world very, very fast. So you have to respond more quickly. But the basic process is the same as it's always been. And it's, by the way, it's the marketer's job to make sure that we deliver. There's a tendency for marketers to think we're clever, creative people, and it's the job of operations people with hairy backsides to actually deliver what we promise. Okay, not good enough. It's our job to make sure the voice of the customer flows through the organisation. Yeah. And by the way, Mr. Yeltsin, he may have been drunk at the time, of course, but the fact that he said the short summary is good, probably if you'd asked the chief executive of General Motors the same question, pretty much any time until they finally did manage to destroy that company, which took 60 years, okay, then he would have told you that things were going well. Because one of the dirty truths in all organisations is everybody lies a bit to their boss about bad news and the boss underestimates it, despite the fact that the boss does the same to the boss's boss. So we might come back to that. It's hugely relevant to market researchers because market research, if it's valid and actionable, achieves absolutely nothing if it doesn't reach decision makers and is acted on. We'll come back to that maybe.
Lorraine, the world of broadcasting, my God, how that has changed in a world where trust is not so easily won and where interactivity is so constant.
Well, I think people are searching always for trusted guides. And you can get very hung up on somebody's blog or somebody's Twitter feed and start to think that is real, if you like, but what you never know is what position they're coming from, what their agenda is. And in a way, the role of organisations like the BBC becomes even more important as trusted aggregators, because everybody's looking for the brands that, do give them, if you like, the truth, in inverted commas.
But how responsive should we be? This is a question about organisations writ large, but specifically I feel it in the BBC. I'm on Twitter. I get people harass you during the programme and afterwards. I introduced someone the other day saying they were on the warpath, a woman, and someone has written to me, I see this morning as I was on my way, to say, oh, you wouldn't say they're on the warpath if it was a man. And I'm thinking, well, I think I probably would, but I'm obviously really offended this person. They felt the right, which they have, immediately to get in touch, and I'll probably respond to her.
Yeah.
later in the day. But where does that leave us as broadcasters who kind of just trust our own judgment to go with it? How cowed are we going to be?
Well, I think it's partly be careful what you wish for, because we all want feedback when it's positive. But, you know, somebody once said to me, you know, reviews are a bit like your horoscopes. You believe them when they're good. And the thing about something like Twitter, or even people who can get access to you via email or anything else, is you get the good, the bad, and the ugly.
And the
but those people expect a response. Yeah. You know, Twitter isn't a broadcast medium, it's an interactive medium, and if either companies or brands or individuals like yourself just use it to say, oh, I want to get my word out there, everybody gets very irritated, because when they respond to you, they want a response back. It's an interactive medium, and I think for all brands, companies, and indeed, you know, high-profile individuals, that interactivity is completely new and very time-consuming, but so important to get it right.
Yeah, time-consuming, my goodness. I mean, in a way, you know, we used to get one letter a year in green ink, which I'd chuck away without reading. Now you get this whole... And actually, I mean, the interesting thing from a broadcaster's perspective, a lot of it is very interesting, actually, and genuinely useful, although, of course, a lot of it isn't. Has it, Matthew, has it changed us intellectually? I mean, the way, or has it changed publics, plural, intellectually, that there is a sense now of constant interactivity in people's minds? In other words, they're thinking, I can get in touch, not just in broadcasting, but I can get in touch with the company and I ought to be able to influence it.
Yeah, my favourite Onion headline, by the way, is White House spokesman, the drugs war is over, the drugs won. I think that, there's two sets of issues here. One is a question about the impact of online interactions and social media. And there I think the latest research is quite disturbing, actually, because it seems from the latest research that it is still the case that online conversations tend to polarize. And indeed, some research published a couple of weeks ago suggests that more polarized positions are more influential. So actually, not only is the debate more polarized, but to be extreme online makes you more influential amongst readers. Now, that's a kind of worrying proposition and goes against, I guess, how we'd like the world to be. On the broader question of trust, there's a kind of fuzzy divide between those people who think that the problem about the decline of trust in traditional institutions is the fault of the institution, and those who think it's the fault of the public. When I worked for Tony Blair and the government was profoundly unpopular, I came to the conclusion it was all the public's fault. and it's an easy position to adopt, actually, because, as we all know, public opinion is highly contradictory. But over time, I've come to the view that wherever the fault lies, actually, the response to this problem of trust, and it can be exaggerated, we've never particularly loved politicians or government, for example, but there is clearly something going on here. Wherever the fault lies, we can't really expect the public to change overnight. It has to be institutions that change. And I think, in essence, that some major factors have shifted this debate. Two I pick out is one is the underperformance of the elite, as it were. 30 years ago, companies and government said to people, you can have a job, it'll be reasonably well paid, your pay will go up every year, it'll be a job for life, and you'll have a decent pension. Now, none of those things currently apply. Living standards have been frozen for most people for a long period and will be for a long period to come. And that kind of promise is not made by employers. Secondly, technology has been very important in this, because technology used to be something which favored the hierarchy, because only large organizations can afford technology, and now technology favors the individual and leaves the hierarchy ever more flat-footed. The consequence of this, I think, is it's institutions that have to change, and I hope we'll talk about this further, but at heart, I think the thing that institutions need to realize is they have to start operating as if they are in a glass box. Now, that's not to say that they should be always transparent. I think transparency is a consequence of virtue, not the driver of virtue. But if organizations are institutions which the public thinks should be accountable and should be acting in the public interest, if those institutions are making decisions which were the public to know about them, the public would not approve of them, then sooner or later they are likely to be in trouble in terms of their reputation. And I think that is not an understanding that most institutions have got. They still believe this is a problem about how it is you find cleverer and cleverer ways of hiding, disguising the fact that your organizational interests don't necessarily align with the public interest. And until institutions realize that unless they achieve almost complete alignment between organizational interests and public interests, then I think these issues of trust and legitimacy will continue to deteriorate.
But does the public know what the public interest is, and particularly those that section of the public that gets in touch vocally with an organisation? Isn't there a risk then that you risk skewing your organisation, whether it's commercial or public sector, towards a group of a ginger group who may or may not actually have their own kind of micro agenda that isn't a wider public?
You know, I think that's absolutely gets to the heart of the issue. And it does it in two ways. First of all, because I believe that at the heart of institutional misbehaviour is very often a profound sense of self-pity. A sense that we as an institution cannot tell the truth about ourselves because the public don't understand. MPs felt the public didn't understand them, and that's why they weren't paid enough, and that's why they could fiddle their expenses. In all the institutions that have made disastrous mistakes, there is a sense that we as an institution must continue, but because the public doesn't understand us and wouldn't understand us if we told them how difficult things are, we have therefore to kind of manipulate what we tell the public and manipulate the way we engage with the public. And that belief is still incredibly strong, but in the end, however difficult it is, institutions have to wear their dilemmas on their sleeves. They have to open up these difficult issues, and they have to challenge the public and develop innovative ways of engaging the public so that the public moves beyond a kind of knee-jerk hostility and to a deeper understanding of the genuine trade-offs that all institutions face.
John Kearon.
Matthew, what kind of self-pity then led Findus to put horse meat in beef lasagna? And at what level could they have ever thought that that behaviour was justifiable?
Well, I think very often in corporations, I can't speak for Findus itself.
No, it's a pity. I was hoping hoping you might. That would be a first.
But
you're not even a non-executive director of Findus, Matthew.
If you want to know what I think is at the heart very often of corporate misbehaviour, it is a self-pitying story about shareholders and competition. And it is an argument that says, well, of course, we would like to do the right thing. We'd like to have a great product which reaches all the highest standards. But if we do, our shareholders, who judge us on an incredibly short-term basis, will punish us if we try to invest, for example, in doing things in a better way. And our competitors, who don't share our standards, will undercut us. And so unless corporations ultimately are willing to sacrifice some element of profitability in defense of a set of standards about what it is that organization is fundamentally about, well, they're going to be in trouble. And the public, that really gets to the heart of a big question for corporate governance right now. I mean, I think, you know, do companies think they are there ultimately to maximize profit, or are they there because they have an intrinsic commitment to standards and to the product and to the service that they provide? And I think many, many organizations are conflicted by that. And many of the reasons why corporations do the wrong thing is they haven't really resolved the issue.
Yeah. John Kearon, I mean, one of the big questions that raised, we might get back to later on, is whether the structure of companies and PLCs and all the rest of it is the right structure to provide what you're talking about. But John Kearon, when you look at how companies behave, I mean, there are companies who get it, but there are plenty who don't.
Well, I was just picking up, you know, Matthew's statement at the end, which is, you know, everyone wants short-term, you know, investors are short-term, and it struck me, it's one of those phrases we let run because it's generally true, but it's true for a reason, and I'm afraid I think it's been true because companies have tried to inflate their share price for a short-term gain for the CEOs and everybody else, and we're talking about trust here. I mean, there are long-term investors out there. There are. But you have to actually have a story which is about long-term, is about building something meaningful and worthwhile. And funny enough, it becomes self-selecting. Those people who invest short-term are listening, frankly, to the self-serving boards who are there to increase their own, you know, remuneration on a short-term basis. And I think it's I just pick it up as an example, I think, of how you undermine trust. And it's done in a sort of subtle way. I mean, people in the audience will know I'm sort of slightly obsessed with behavioral economics at the moment. And actually, the way we make these judgments, I think, is very much more a system one pattern recognition. It's not actually the detail. We get a literal gut feel about something, about an institution, where they undermine themselves and they lose that trust little by little by little by little until the pattern, you know, until we suddenly, a bit, I'm afraid, education is getting close to that at the moment, a bit like the government promised us a job and, you know, pensions, and actually now education has promised if you do this and you pass your exams, you will somehow succeed. Not true, I am afraid. And so there's a sudden kind of questioning of the most conservative bastion of British life and social life. And it strikes me that it's, I mean, from a research point of view, can you measure, you know, can you even detect, can you sense when this shift is happening? Because as Paddy said, you know, it's fluid at the moment. And we did a fascinating study, which actually probably shouldn't say, because it was in China, America, and Europe. And the trouble with China, if anyone's doing research there, is you're not really allowed to do any social research there. And it's telling, because China's the one place which is still sort of controlling the message in a way that the West has completely lost control, and therefore the authority figures are shifting in a more dynamic way, a quite interesting way, whereas in China, everyone still trusts the government, doctors, education, in a kind of absolutely absolute way relative to the West. And so I'm not sure good, you know, well, you know, it's like freedom and being able to challenge all the Twitter sphere that we were talking about earlier does, I think, make authority and trust more fluid than it has ever been. Yeah. And I suspect that's quite an interesting place to be.
Camilla Harrison, you're in the business of influencing people. And where do you see this business of public trust and how it can be marshalled, if that's the right word, and where it is?
Well, I think... I mean, I sort of concur with a lot of what's been said. I think the train's left the station on sort of transparency. And I think that now, if brands aren't transparent, by definition, they're going to be treated with suspicion, particularly when things start to go wrong. And if you're going to be transparent as a brand, I think what you've also got to be is simple as a brand, because if you're transparent but complex in a way that people can't understand and relate to that brand and that business, that's not really transparency. And I think there's businesses and brands in that space who are attempting to be more transparent, but they need to probably get back to their knitting, be clear about what they are and what they do. Because if you confuse people, that's another version of being opaque. And I think the other thing is the role of the individuals behind brands is more important than it ever was. So I think people want people to step up. People want people behind brands to take personal accountability. And we talk about the horse meat scandal and stuff, and there was this silence, this sort of silence of where are the CEOs and who's saying what. And what people wanted was people to come out quickly. And even if things weren't perfect and they were saying, to be honest, we don't really know, what they wanted was a voice. And that train is on its way, you know, the momentum starts. And once the ball started rolling, it's harder and harder for that individual to come out. And so to come out and be honest and nip it in the bud on behalf of the business and behalf of the brand. So the role of individuals and spokespeople, and I think that has a massive impact on the kind of people who speak on behalf of business and the speed at which they speak. I mean, there was this unbelievable story about David and Victoria Beckham. I don't know if you heard this, and they had a bet with each other about his new tattoo, and she took a photo of it and said, how quickly can we get this on the Mail Online? And she tweeted a photo of his new tattoo, and it was on the Mail Online within 3 minutes, and that's 120 million unique visitors a month on that site. And it's just phenomenal. So you've just got to zap it. And but I think that changes
things. Can I just endorse what Camilla said about spokespeople? Because this is also a competitive opportunity. In the case of the horses, it was actually Peter Marks of the Co-op who went on the 9 o'clock news and the 10 o'clock news and fessed up maybe a day or two too late.
Who is what? He's
the chief executive of the Co-op.
Because that's the other point. Are spokespeople enough? I mean, does it also involve, must it involve CEOs?
It has to be CEOs, and he, you know, stood up and said, we have got this wrong collectively, and it's our job to get it right. That was good for his brand, The fact that he stepped forward when bigger people like Tesco's, you know, initially were not. So it is, in fact, a competitive opportunity. This was an industry-wide problem. And so you can also see this in the competitive space. Usually it's an individual brand.
By that, do you mean that this event may have just launched the horse meat industry in the UK? We're talking about the shock of the new.
Well, interestingly,
it's a tasty meat.
No, I mean, really, interestingly, it did do that. There's clear signs of that.
No, but somebody is, there's a restaurant now that's serving horse steak.
Yeah.
So there is now a market for horse meat, which did not exist before. Okay. Yeah. Bear in mind, you know, London is the number six French city in the world as well. So
I've
also found it quite bizarre that whilst all this was going on, there was the papal enclave going on, you know, with sort of people covering it saying, still no spoke. And there's a lot of, you know, where we're looking for all this transparency, you had this sort of decision-making process that's sort of wrapped in secrecy. And, you know, I don't know what people feel about that, but at a time where the church is where it is, it was quite a contrast, these two stories sort of running concurrently in the press.
Yeah, but you do wonder, actually, whether some of the kind of sort of groundswell of bad press that the Catholic Church gets comes from this dissonance, if that's the right word, between what how you see the Catholic Church organises itself and how you're all suggesting organisations, other organisations, people want to know what's going on. Yeah, to an extent that they didn't in the past. I'm going to throw it open now to anyone who wants us to take us in, well, virtually any direction. I might have to draw some boundaries, I suppose. We've got microphones we've got people with microphones, I think, even better, who are going to... yes, is that right? Yes, yeah, they have, who can dot between folk, and if you can just briefly say who you are and then and address a question or make a point if it's pithy. I don't know if anyone's come across the work of Nate Silver specifically on the subject. I mean, he's written a very good book, hasn't he, about the whole business of how you work out what is sort of true and false, I suppose, in the modern world with all the information and noise that there is around. But one of the things that really struck me with the American view is that in America there is much more access, in a sense, to information. People get their news a lot from the internet. There are tons of sources, but of course a lot of those sources are utterly tainted, and they tend to reinforce what you yourself think. And one of the things Nate Silver suggests is that actually in the modern world, and I think he suggests an analogy with the 14th century and the invention of the printing press, that actually you get the printing press and there's tons more dissemination of information, and you also then get a massive kind of war that lasts 100 years, because what dissemination of information doesn't seem to do is make people, and this in a sense goes back to your point, Matthew, make people feel more gently disposed, more reasonably disposed towards the other person's point of view. Actually, it can have the effect of making you think, my goodness, I get all this information myself. Why don't they understand that it's true? And I just wonder how individuals deal with the mass of stuff that there is out there. Information isn't quite the right word, but the mass of guff.
Well, I don't think that people exactly know how to deal with it. I think a lot of the information which comes to people isn't particularly salient to them, so they don't spend a great deal of time interrogating it. I think the really interesting question for this sector is this. If I was to say to somebody in this room, if I was to walk up to you and say, I know more about you than you know about yourself, you'd be intensely irritated and somewhat threatened. And you'd be right, in my view, to be intensely irritated and somewhat threatened. But yet, in quite important ways, the advent of mass data, big data, does leave corporations... and we all know the kind of the biggest ones of the most power in the position where, in some senses, they do know more about us than we know about ourselves. In terms of our habits, and also picking up John's point about behavioral economics, they are acutely aware of our cognitive idiosyncrasies. So they are aware of the fact that, for example, 90% of people think they're above average drivers. They know that we are very bad at making decisions in the short term which align with our long-term intentions. And what is interesting, I think, is generally speaking, there's not a great deal of innovation which is designed to help us manage our cognitive frailties. Because if I was to say to you, I know more about you than you know about yourself, One of the things that would matter intensely importantly to you, if you'd once you'd reconciled yourself to that uncomfortable fact, were my intentions good or were my intentions bad? That would matter enormously to you. And I think it does matter enormously to people. And I think there is a dearth of innovation taking place in the sector, which is genuinely exploring how it is that people can reconcile effective marketing with giving people the kinds of information and the kinds of advice they need to make wise decisions. Now, not in a paternalistic way, but in a reflexive way, helping people to understand. So, for example, let me just finish with this. Take an example. The financial services sector has basically been for 30 years a conspiracy to exploit our cognitive frailties. Almost every product that has been developed in order to exploit our cognitive frailties. Now, there's a genuine challenge for this sector now in its marketing. Has it got a way of making money which doesn't exploit those frailties? Has it got a way of making money which encourages to make wise decisions and not unwise decisions? And I don't think the sector has really got its head around that at all.
Mm. Privacy. Where are we? One thing that you could do as a sort of generalized view is take the view that people, as youngsters who are used to using social media get older, we will care less about privacy than we do at the moment. Do you think that's potentially true, Camilla?
Well, I believe that younger people are, what I've seen is that younger people have a different relationship with privacy to certainly my generation. And that I think, you know, it's interesting what Matthew's saying about how you look at people. We did some work with Google about privacy, and one of the things we were trying to do in a campaign was trying to encourage people to take responsibility for their own privacy settings and to understand that there were privacy settings, that they had privacy settings, that they could set those privacy settings, and what the data was there for in the first place was to help make search easier and all that sort of thing. But the moment you get into the word privacy, people pretty much shut down because they sort of feel that it is... Yeah. So it's very difficult to find a platform to even have that kind of conversation on. And I think that one of the things about all the information that we've just talked about is trying to work out what information actually matters to you as a person. Yes. Privacy for me, there's loads of stuff I don't care if people know about me. And actually, there's loads of stuff that just isn't very important. But stuff that helps me recognise the stuff that does matter, and I think that is, again, that's one of the big challenges with research per se and with information and with data and everything else. It's not that it's good or bad or anything like that. It's helping navigate it and helping to identify the stuff that is of value to me as a person and the stuff that I do want to protect, and helping an organisation's respecting that and valuing that as well.
John?
There's an interesting sort of guru, Jaron Lanier, who's just published a book, and he's the dreadlocked future thinker. And his sense is the whole privacy... What's currently a privacy debate is going to turn into almost the modern equivalent of democracy as it started. In other words, the power that we have to view and to give our attention will become a currency, and needs to and should do. And actually, that's when suddenly the whole thing might shift.
Give an example then of how that...
In that, at the moment, the likes of Google, because we feel generally good towards them, we allow huge amount of benefit to accrue to them through using them, whereas actually people power, the same people who are accruing that benefit, could choose to vote differently if it was framed in that way, or if it was if we had a sense of our own power.
It's empowerment, it's not knowing. I think that's the issue, is that people believe that stuff is being taken from them without their knowledge, and I think that's at the heart of the privacy thing, is understanding. And I think the challenge is, how do you put people in charge of their own personal data and privacy?
And
because actually it's very confusing, and they're not that interested. They just don't like the idea of someone taking it without... Yeah.
Which obviously has profound implications for the health service and the way we deal with the medical profession. My son has a chronic illness called type 1 diabetes that involves wearing an insulin pump. And one of the big issues in the future, obviously everything is now digitally able to communicate with everything else, there's absolutely no reason at all why his insulin level shouldn't be monitored by someone in India or by his GP or by a hospital or by 1,000 hospitals. And of course, the data then used in a way that is useful to everyone with it. And I actually don't think he's 12 at the moment. I don't think when he's in when he grows up, I don't think he'll care. But I think now it's still a very big hurdle to cross, isn't it? And it's a hurdle that they're trying to grapple with at the moment in number 10. Your success is there. This business of how you persuade the public that there are real values in having this stuff out there. And it can be anonymized to an extent that doesn't affect you as a person.
I think before, there was lots of information held about us, but it was all held in completely different places. And now, through Google, because it's a platform that we do lots and lots of different things on, it starts to be held in one place. So they can find out about lots of different aspects of our lives through the various communications we have, through the purchases we have, you know, through our security codes that we choose to put in and what have you. And, you know, partly you think it must be a bit like the old days of the Soviet Union where there were so many spies watching so many people that nobody could in the end make sense of any of it because there was just too much data. And that's what I partly feel now. There's so much data. How can they really make sense of any of it or make use of any of it or all of it? So maybe we don't need to worry so much, but it's just this feeling that if it did start to be abused or if, I don't know, somebody who we felt was malevolent took over this information, then all sorts of things could happen with it that wouldn't be to our benefit.
But one distinction that I've sort of found interesting recently is feedback loops versus big data. So big data in itself, Nassim Taleb, I think, talks about this. Big data just means bigger error because you can find correlations all over the place, but actually they're nonsense. Whereas anything that has a feedback loop generally is a virtuous, like your example with, you know, with your son. Feedback loops are powerful progress machines. And yes, the digital world provides these massive, you know, feedback loops, which I think is generally for the good. Big data, I'm not so sure.
Come on, someone say something. I throw it over. Yeah, two people right at the front. Oh, a microphone person is hurtling towards you. Let's hear from both of you, and then we can throw it. Yeah, a little bit further, actually, right here. Yeah. If you just briefly say who you are.
I'm Paul Edwards from Hall & Partners. I'm interested in trust in the opposite direction. How much should we trust tweets? How much should we trust blogs? And dare I ask, how much should we trust respondents in research who tell us things?
Yeah, good one. And then the gentleman across the way as well.
Thank you. I'm Brian Tarrin from Research. I wanted to ask us about the World Federation of Advertisers did a survey recently that said 80% of marketers in future believed that brands needed to have a sense of social purpose in order to succeed. I wondered how much of that would go towards rebuilding trust in brands and how much of that is trying to distract attention away from being too transparent about them themselves. Mm. So almost, you know, putting the attention on the good they do rather than what they do.
Patrick.
Well, I think on the sort of trust respondents, of course, this is really an old question we've always had. I think in general, with things like survey research, in general, respondents really do their best to give you sort of valid answers. And even if you've written an incompetent questionnaire, they'll quite often give you the answer to the question you should have asked because they know what you're sort of getting at. I'm a great believer in piloting sort of five times as much as common sense suggests in order that you sort of reduce that. Having said that, obviously there's the whole sort of issue of we have this huge sort of conscious cognitive bias, the kind of stuff that John and his colleagues at Brainjuicer are working on, at which we now have a project called Real Consumers, which is about, you know, can we draw on behavioral economics, and I think in 10 years' time, behavioral economics and neuroeconomics, in order to at least get a better understanding of, you know, the rest of the iceberg, which is subconscious. So I think in general, what you get from respondents is responses generally, you know, which are valid in terms of what they think you're asking about and what they think they do. Even in that case, it can be very distorted. So something we found with new media, for instance, is that even when we have filmed people in their homes for 3 weeks, and then ask them, you know, how much time do they spend watching live TV versus time shifted and which, how many commercials. They genuinely believe they've sort of stopped watching live TV. It's not that they're lying. It's not they're trying to impress you. It's that people's genuine self-perception. And that's sort of part of why we get all this sort of bollocks 2.0 about you know, television's all about mainstream TV viewing is about to go on the internet and so on. And so I think there are some cases where there is genuine misperception, and then there are other cases, which is the sort of thing that John and colleagues are working on, which is you have to use more subtle methods and possibly indirect methods in order to access that aspect. Mm. Brands and social purpose, I'm skeptical about whether we are actually going to see companies saying we're going to make a trade-off between profit and the interests of other stakeholders. I don't see that happening. What I think we can aim for is more sort of enlightened self-interest. I don't think that trust is closely related to sort of corporate social responsibility. I think trust is primarily to do with having a promise and then delivering on it. But that promise may include tacit aspects such as, you know, there is no horse in this burger. Okay, so you don't say that explicitly, but, you know, people assumed it and then felt let down. So I think that the sort of CSR in the sense of doing good in the world and the environment and all that is a little bit separate from you know, the core issue of trust, which is you gave me a promise and you gave me quite a lot of implicit promise and you didn't keep that promise.
So separate that it doesn't matter to the brand?
It matters much less, I think. I think it matters much less. Now, it's complicated because when we use the word brand, there are three valid uses of the word brand, and people get their knickers in a twist about this. The great Jeremy Bullmore said, when CEOs think about brands, their brains hurt. And, you know, which is true. There's brand as in named product or service. Which brand did you buy? There's brand in the sense of trademark, okay, which brand should we use for this new product? And then there's brand in the sense of brand equity. You know, will this activity damage our brand, which is roughly reputation? And I think it's in the context of that third one that sort of trust is absolutely key. Yeah. So CSR, I think, can influence that at the margin. I personally don't think it's core, with one big proviso, which is an increasing part of marketing in the next 20 years is going to be about internal marketing. And I think, when one of the reasons why most organizational transformations fail is because, you know, people at the top assume that the motivators for everyone else are the same as for them. And so they give all this sort of shareholder language and they use a lot of fear about, you know, the competition will destroy us and so on. And that is one of the motivators for everybody else. But another one is people actually prefer to work for companies that they think are making the world a better place. Okay. So through that indirect route, I think it's enlightened self-interest.
I think it has to be sincere. You know, it can't be a cynical thing to do CSR. So if you're just doing it like, I don't know, say a tobacco company decides to sponsor medical research, you think, okay, why are you actually doing this? Or an oil company has a massive oil spill and then they suddenly start doing something for the environment. So there can be a cynical mismatch, if you like, between what one bit of your company is doing and what another is. And it can't be a fig leaf. But in terms of employee engagement, if you like, I totally agree with Paddy that a lot of people want to feel, and it is very important to them, that they work for a company that does good beyond, if you like, its role just as the company. So whether that's going out into the community to do voluntary work or whether it's having mass fundraising events, I think, you know, that is increasingly important to lots of people.
Matthew.
It's important, I think, to recognise that trust has got two elements to it. We talk about trusting inanimate objects, and what we mean by that is that they're reliable. So there's a reliability element to trust, and there's an ethical element to trust. I also think people's relationships vary enormously depending on how much they feel they have invested in that. And I think, generally speaking, it's still the case that people feel they have less invested in commercial brands than they do, for example, in democratic institutions. Mm. And that's why I think data is important. in this debate, because I think that the idea that commercial institutions have the kind of data which in the past we might only have thought the government had about us and would have been uneasy about that, may shift people's sense of what they want to know about those organisations and what it is that motivates them. I don't think it's about corporate social responsibility. I think it's about, as I said earlier, about aligning the best interests of your organisation with what the public thinks you ought to be about, which doesn't mean that the public thinks that commercial organisations ought to be driven entirely by social purpose. They understand they're commercial organisations, but they want to believe that they are seeking in every way they can to reconcile the commercial imperatives with a sense of public good. In relation to the point about the public and the way they answer questions, I think the thing that Patrick missed out really in his account is that what people say in answer to questions and what they say when they have a chance to reflect on an issue are often very different things. So we know from citizens' juries around the world, for example, that generally speaking, people go into citizens' juries, which are kind of two-day intensive events on law and order issues. They go in as Daily Mail readers and they emerge as Guardian readers because they've had a chance to think about it, and they've had a chance to focus not on kind of knee-jerk desire for revenge and outrage, but actually, well, what is likely to work in terms of solutions which are going to make society more peaceful? And they have a chance to reflect on how they would feel if a member of their own family behaved, all those kinds of things. Now, the reason this is important, and I want to try and form a kind of a loop here, because maybe the last chance I get to speak, is that I was talking earlier about this problem about if the conversation you are having within your organisation is not a conversation the public will approve of, you are in trouble. And one of the reasons I think the politics is in the very, very bad state that it's in is because politicians are having a conversation consistently, which is not, what is it I need to say that is true? What is it that the public needs to hear if the public is going to grasp this issue? But they're having a conversation which is to say, what can I say which will make me popular in the short term? And what can I say which might generate the headlines that I want? And that is not an authentic position. That is not the position the public wants politicians to take. It is not the conversation the public wants the politicians to be having. And the public is quite aware of that. And that is one of the things that drives cynicism. And when you see the continual use by politicians, let me give you one tiny example. Politicians continually refer to the idea that most people on benefits have been on benefits all their lives, and their grandfathers were, and their grandfathers were. In fact, if you look at the data, a tiny minority of claimants have been on benefits for years and years and years. Three quarters of people on benefits have been in work in the last year. But the myth, it speaks to a set of prejudices we have, and so politicians use it when it's not the truth, and they know it's not the truth. And the point is this. Politicians have to get the courage to engage us in difficult questions, because it's when we understand that there are genuine dilemmas and trade-offs that we answer the questions more intelligently. We are more likely to come up with with views which are reasonably balanced. But if politics continues to exist at the level of initial knee-jerk responses to questions and a notion of opinion forming which is like that, then that sense of inauthenticity in politics and distrust in politics will continue.
Last minute or two, there's a person just behind. Yep. Get the microphone to her, and this will be where we finish. Yes.
Hi, I'm Naomi Jones, and that's in social research. I'm just interested in this point of inauthenticity. Is social media not perhaps fueling that, because it allows this really one-dimensional view, so you can follow a politician or organisation or individual, and you think you get to know what they're saying, you think that they're feigning transparency through their Twitter feed or whatever, but actually it's all spin, because you can present a very one-dimensional particular view of what you're saying, and is it not perhaps a barrier to creating the kind of transparency that Matthew, you're talking about?
Yeah, and also you think you can influence them.
You do, yeah.
That illusion builds up, whereas why the hell should you? You're just one person on the end of a Twitter feed. I mean,
yeah, but you feel like you know their lives, don't you?
And yeah.
It's myth.
That is true, isn't it, Camilla? I mean, it's an odd relationship that we've built up now with our politicians and companies.
I think individuals, brands, organisations, there are people and organisations who use social media and Twitter brilliantly. And I think there are other people who use it as a fig leaf and use it in the way that Matthew's just described, that politicians use issues, which is to try and present something. And I think by and large, people are quite wise to it.
But you can't be too authentic. Well, can you be too genuinely authentic as a commercial enterprise on your Twitter feed? Can you give people, and almost as a sort of technical thing, can you give people the wherewithal, the power in a company, the person who's answering the Twitter stuff, to say, get lost, actually, we think horse is good for you, or you know.
Well, I think you can't. In a lot of organisations, you can't. And you look at lots of CEOs, and they will not. They will not embrace social media.
But a lot of this, look, if you put people in a room together and you say, what's your opinion? It's going to be messy and loud and pointless. If you say to them, what are we going to do to solve this problem? You're going to get a different type of discourse. And I think that the companies understand, what the best companies like Unilever, for example, understand that when they've got a dilemma, how do we have a product which is sustainable? Instead of just saying, what's your opinion to customers, which is kind of rubbish in, rubbish out, what you say to your customers is, how can you help us design products which are going to meet your aspiration for something which is effective and which is value, but is also not bad for the environment?
Human beings are designed to try and detect lying. I mean, you know, because it's such a social thing. And the trouble is, we're not that good at it. And therefore, when people are discovered to be undermining, they are punished in the most, you know, sort of extreme way. Like the founder of Whole Foods, you know, who was thought of as one of those sort of personal leaders, suddenly blogging and tweeting in someone else's name, you know, slagging off his competitors. It was just such a weird, this hippie doing this thing. And
Never trust a hippie.
Never trust a hippie. That is probably a very good moment at which to end a profound thought from our panel. Thank you all very much indeed. Round of applause for them, please.